a critical time. We know the many sacrifices you and your family have made. We are proud of the work you have done. We hope to benefit from your abilities and experience after your service in the Army is complete. You have a great deal still to offer our nation and its security. General Campbell, you have presided over important progress in improving the capability and capacity of the Afghan military. You've developed a strong and productive relationship with the Afghan unity government, and when you saw that our hard-won gains were in danger, you spoke up for what was right, that further troop withdrawals should be based on conditions on the ground. Your successor will profit greatly from your leadership and your record of service. In 2001, U.S. forces went to Afghanistan because that was where, under the sanctuary of the Taliban regime, al-Qaeda planned and trained for the September 11th attacks that killed 3,000 innocent civilians on American soil. Our mission was to ensure that Afghanistan would never again be a safe haven for al-Qaeda or other terrorist groups to attack the United States or our allies and partners. That mission has been successful for 14 years, but it's far from over. U.S. forces are carrying out the mission today by performing two critical tasks, counterterrorism and training, advising and assisting our Afghan partners. Both of these tasks are vital to achieving our strategic goals in protecting our homeland. We're taking the fight to America's enemies in Afghanistan while at the same time building a sustainable Afghan security forces that can stand on its own, take on violent extremists, and deny terrorists safe haven in their country. But I fear that the latest calendar-based withdrawal plan places these missions and therefore our nation's security at risk. While President Obama made the right decision to keep 9,800 U.S. troops in Afghanistan, he repeated again the strategic folly of setting a timetable for withdrawal that ignores conditions on the ground, discourages our friends, and gives hope to our enemies. I continue to be disheartened by the perpetual political focus on troop numbers. This decision should be first about what capabilities we need to protect our national security, and second, about the number of troops it takes to enable those capabilities. The 5,500 U.S. troops that will be left in Afghanistan if this plan goes forward will be adequate for either the counterterrorism mission or the trained advise and consent mission, but not both. This smaller American force will inevitably be forced to shoulder a higher level of risk to themselves, to their mission, and to the national security of the United States. The risk to American forces only grows worse as the terrorist threat in Afghanistan intensifies. The Taliban, al-Qaeda, and the Haqqani network continue to threaten our interests in Afghanistan and beyond. Now ISIL has arrived on the battlefield, raising the specter of yet another ISIL safe haven from which it can plan and execute attacks. This complex and expanding terrorist threat is a test both for us as well as the Afghan military, which must still develop key enabling capabilities, including intelligence, logistics, special forces, airlift, and close air support. In short, as General Campbell said in his prepared statement, Afghan has not achieved an enduring level of security and stability that justifies a reduction of our support in 2016. As a result, the conditions on the ground simply do not warrant a further withdrawal of U.S. forces. By now, we should have learned from the precipitous withdrawal from Iraq and the disaster that ensued that wars do not end just because politicians say so. Many of us are also increasingly concerned that our rules of engagement, as dictated by the authorities the President gives to our commanders on the ground, are making our mission more difficult and increasing the risk to our troops. For example, it is stunning that up until just a few weeks ago, we had to wait for ISIL to attack or threaten our forces in Afghanistan before taking action. General Campbell has talked about the importance of making the fight against violent extremists like al-Qaeda and ISIL an away game. I fear that restrictive authorities dictated by a White House overly involved in battlefield tactical decision is inviting a home game as we saw in Paris and San Bernardino. To secure Afghanistan and prevent another attack on our homeland requires the right capabilities in the right places, supported by the right number of people with the right authorities. It's time to give our commanders the resources and authorities they need to seize the initiative and force the enemy to react instead of the other way around. The world walked away from Afghanistan once before, and it descended into chaos that contributed to the worst terrorist attack ever against our homeland. We cannot afford to repeat that mistake because the threats we face are real and the stakes are high for the lives of the Afghan people, for the stability of the region, and for the national security of the United States. President Obama has the opportunity to make decisions now that will empower his successor to do what is necessary to confront the challenges we will face in Afghanistan in 2017 and beyond. I hope he will seize that opportunity. General Campbell, after your 18 months on the ground in Afghanistan, almost 37 years of distinguished service in the Army, this committee looks forward to hearing what you believe the United States, our coalition partners, and our Afghan friends need to do differently to put 2016 on a better course than 2015. Senator Reid.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and let me join you in welcoming General Campbell and thanking him and saluting him for his extraordinary service to the nation and to the Army. For the past 18 months, you have led with distinction in Afghanistan. You've seen a significant transition during that period of time, and your leadership has been critical to the successes we've seen there and to the situation we now enjoy. I look forward to continuing our relationship, but I know you're contemplating retirement. I want to thank you for your service and also thank your family who has served so well and so faithfully with you. So thank you very much, sir. President Obama announced on October 15, 2015, that U.S. troop levels will remain at 900-800 personnel for most of 2016, but with a planned reduction to 5,500 personnel by January 1, 2017. Our forces, in conjunction with NATO and other allies, continue to have two missions: train, assist, and advise the Afghan National Security Forces, or NNSF, and conduct counterterrorism operations. And key to enabling both missions, the President also announced in October that our troops would remain at a small number of bases, including Bagram, Jalalabad in the east, and Kandahar in the south, rather than falling back to a Kabul-centric footprint. This adequately staffed and geographically dispersed approach has allowed us to support our missions in Afghanistan and encourage political and governmental reforms by President Ghani and Chief Executive Officer Abdullah. It also signals to our allies of our resolve and the need for their continued commitment. The ANSF recently completed their first calendar year bearing sole responsibility for the security of Afghanistan, albeit with significant enabling support from the coalition. The past year presented the ANSF with an array of challenges, but they maintained their overall operational coherence despite a notable shift in Taliban operations from seasonal fighting to a continuously sustained effort. In addition, the emergence of the Islamic State in the Khorasan province, or ISKP, and the continuing, indeed, increased threat of al-Qaeda elements within Afghanistan. General Campbell, I look forward to your assessment of the performance of the ANSF over the past year and plans for addressing remaining capability shortfalls. Given the dynamic security environment in Afghanistan, it is important that we continually evaluate the assumptions underlying our force posture in Afghanistan. As Lieutenant General Nicholson stated last week, if confirmed, he intends to take the first few months of his command to assess what capabilities and associated number of troops he believes we will need to remain in Afghanistan in order to successfully carry out the train, advise, and assist in counterterror missions. I believe that additional troop withdrawals in Afghanistan should be conditions-based, and that any recommendations resulting from Lieutenant General Nicholson's assessment should be given extraordinary weight. General Campbell, I hope you will share with the committee your views on the number of troops and pace of withdrawal you would recommend for 2016, and whether events of the past year have illuminated ways in which we can better enable security operations by the Afghans. Lastly, as we look forward to the 2016 NATO Warsaw Summit in July, it will be important for the National Unity Government led by President Ghani and Chief Executive Officer Abdullah to demonstrate progress on anti-corruption and other governance initiatives, to give the international community confidence that its assistance is being effectively utilized. Continued international support is going to be very important over the next few years. General Campbell, I would also welcome your assessment of progress on these issues and how your command is assisting the Afghans in providing accountability for support provided through the Afghan Security Forces Fund and other sources. 2016 is going to be a critical year of transition for Afghanistan, and decisions by the U.S. and our coalition partners over the next few months could significantly impact the trajectory of the country. I believe steady, predictable U.S. presence and assistance is necessary for continued success. General Campbell, again, thank you for your service. Thank you, sir.
General Campbell, welcome.
Good morning, Chairman O'Kane, Ranking Member Reed, and other distinguished members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today while representing all the servicemen and women of the United States Forces of Afghanistan. And I've been honored to lead and represent all of them and what they do here for the last 18 months, and it's truly been a privilege and an honor to do so. I'd like to begin by thanking the committee again for your steadfast support of our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and our civilians. And due to your leadership and commitment, they continue to be the best trained, equipped force that our nation has ever deployed. The remarkable performance bears true testimony to your backing and the backing of the American people. I'd also like to recognize the unsung heroes of our nation, and that is our military families. They've stood by us for 14 to 15 years of conflict. They endure the hardships of frequent absences, and they allow us to focus on our mission. And without their love and support, we could not succeed. So we thank them for their continued support. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge and honor the over 2,200 servicemen and women who have died in Afghanistan since 2001, and the over 20,000 who have been wounded. Tragically, we recently lost 6 U.S. airmen to a motorcycle-borne IED attack just before Christmas, and then a special forces advisor just after the new year. And these losses remind us that Afghanistan continues to be a very dangerous place. And while we take every measure to reduce force protection threats, our service members, our civilians, and our coalition partners remain in harm's way. We also remember the fallen of the Afghan security forces and the loved ones that they've left behind. They now bear the brunt of this conflict as they fight to bring peace and security to Afghanistan. Every day, we honor their memories by assisting our Afghan partners as they fight to improve security and, by extension, help us protect our own homeland. The men and women I serve with have not forgotten why we are in Afghanistan, and we remain there to ensure that another terrorist attack originating from Afghanistan and directed against U.S. homeland will never, ever happen again. That is why the counterterrorism mission remains critical to our mutual security interests. Yet we recognize the importance of our train, advise, and assist mission as we build a sustainable Afghan security force, capable of standing alone in its mission of countering violent extremists and denying terrorists safe haven. This is a shared vital interest among Afghanistan, United States, and the international community. Those who serve in this mission understand that Afghanistan is worth our investment. It is their commitment that keeps us focused on our vision for a stable and secure Afghanistan. Together, the train, advise, and assist efforts, coupled with our counterterrorism mission, underpin our overall mission. Just 4 months have passed since I last appeared before this committee. Even in that short time, there have been many developments in the security situation. The progress of the Afghan government and its security forces, our coalition's commitments, and of course, the U.S. way ahead in 2016 and beyond. Today, I will speak to these developments and answer questions you may have on the state of our efforts and the overall situation in Afghanistan. Specifically, I'd like to address the lessons we learned from this last year, how we intend to ensure that 2016 is different from 2015, and how we see 2017 and beyond. To assess these questions, we must ask ourselves, what else can we do to enable the Afghan security forces? And what else can the Afghans do for themselves to secure their country? 2015 was fundamentally different than previous years of our campaign. It is important to remember this in context as we assess our efforts in Afghanistan. First, Afghanistan's government and security forces have managed multiple transitions in 2015. Second, the U.S. and coalition mission and force structure has significantly changed. And third, changing regional dynamics, including evolving threats, have presented both challenges and opportunities for our success. As I travel around Afghanistan, I recognize the changes and the progress made over the years of this mission. This is my third deployment to Afghanistan over the last 14 years, and I have served as senior commander for the last 18 months. And I am ever mindful of how far we've come, but I remain clear-eyed about the challenges that lie ahead. Now more than ever, the United States should not waver on Afghanistan. The crucial investment we are making provides dividends that achieve our strategic goals, secure our homeland, and position us well in a region that has been a source of terrorism and instability for decades. Many of you have heard me say that for every bad news story we hear coming out of Afghanistan, there are 10 good news stories we don't. While this is to be expected, I think it tints our view of our progress and prospects for success in Afghanistan. It is my intent to provide a balanced assessment that not only exposes the challenges that lie ahead, but also illustrates our gains in the Afghan progress. With that in mind, I'd like to address the concerns of what many feel is an overall declining security situation in Afghanistan. The situation is more dynamic than a simple yes or no answer would adequately address. In fact, as of last week, the units we have on the ground throughout the country report that of the 407 district centers, 8 of them, or 2%, are under insurgent control. We assess that another 18, or 4%, are under what we call insurgent influence. Often these district centers are in remote and sparsely populated areas that security forces are not able to access very often in force. Additionally, at any given time, there may be up to 94 district centers, around 23%, that we view as at risk. These figures make two clear points. Number one, that approximately 70% of the inhabited parts of Afghanistan are either under government influence or government control. And two, the importance of prioritizing Afghan resources to ensure key district centers do not fall into insurgent influence or control. Over the last 8 years, the Afghan security forces have made advancements, beginning as an unorganized collection of militia and developing into a modern security force, with many of the systems and processes of an advanced military. They have proven resilient and continue to make significant strides in only the second year in which Afghan forces assume the lead for security throughout Afghanistan. They have demonstrated the ability to successfully conduct effective large-scale multi-pillar clearing operations across the country, including in Helmand, Ghazni, and Nangarhar. Following insurgent offenses, the Afghan security forces were able to retake key territory, as they did in Kunduz, with strong performances from all the security pillars. Simultaneously, while the tactical units were conducting these operations, the security institutions had to continue developing the force. This includes many complex tasks such as budgeting, force generation, personnel management, national level maintenance, logistics, and procurement. These are areas that challenge even the most advanced militaries in the world. And I like to say what we have accomplished there is akin to building an airplane while in flight. And while these systems are far from perfect, the foundation has been laid. And we continue to advise and assist the Afghans as they build a sustainable security force that is enduring and capable of standing on its own. With the Afghans in the lead for security for the first time in 2015, the enemy and the naysayers predicted collapse of the Afghan security forces and the Afghan government. They sought to capitalize on this. Instead, the Afghan security forces fought for the very survival of their country and held firm. They did not fracture, and they kept the insurgents from achieving their strategic goals while inflicting higher casualties on the enemies. They did this while maintaining a significantly higher operational tempo with significantly reduced coalition support. However, the lessons learned in 2015 underscore the Afghan shortfalls will persist beyond 2016. Capability gaps still exist in the fixed and rotary wing aviation, combined arms operations, intelligence collection, dissemination, and maintenance. More prominently, one of the greatest tactical challenges for the Afghan security forces has been overcoming the Afghan Air Force's extremely limited organic close air support capability. Admittedly, we began building the Afghan Air Force late and were constrained by the time it takes to build human capital. Those capability gaps notwithstanding, I still assess that at least 70% of the problems facing Afghan security forces result from poor leadership. Minister of Defense Standing Zai recognizes this. To date, Afghan National Army has replaced 92 general officers, including the 215th Corps Commander in Helmand. The MOI is lagging behind in making leadership changes, but we're taking steps to remedy this through our Train, Advise, and Assist mission. This kind of change takes time. I have seen that the consequences of Kunduz and Helmand still weigh heavily on the leadership of both the security forces and the Afghan government. They realize that, although not strategically significant in the pure military sense, those incidents shaped media coverage and undermine the confidence in the government. Their desire to do better runs deep and is genuine. In many ways, these events forced a greater sense of urgency to make the changes they greatly require. Over the last year, there have been many positive trends. However, Afghan security forces have not consolidated significant gains of their own, nor defeated the insurgency across Afghanistan. Suffice it to say, the performance this year was uneven. To be fair, this was not unexpected, given the overall conditions. Ultimately, Afghanistan has not achieved an enduring level of security and stability that justifies a reduction in our support in 2016. That is why the President's decision to maintain current force levels through most of 2016 was welcome and important. This decision set the example for NATO, encouraging other allies and partner nations to maintain, or in some cases, increase their contributions to the Resolute Support mission. During this winter lull, we are focusing on steps to best prepare the Afghan security forces for the summer campaign of 2016. Their leadership shares this focus, and they are dedicated to resetting the force, implementing reforms to improve training, equipping, and rebuilding of units that have endured unusually high operational tempo for long periods of time, especially those forces in Helmand. Such reforms are critical and are taking root with the Afghan security forces, but broader reforms remain important to success in Afghanistan. The Afghan government, including its security institutions, continues to show progress in battling corruption and achieving other reforms such as gender integration. However, much work still needs to be done. We fully understand that many want to see more progress on social and human rights issues before continuing to commit resources to Afghanistan. The National Unity Government also recognizes this and has welcomed our increased use of conditionality to usher change. They understand the importance of stability, opportunity, and hope. They understand the importance that keeping the donor nations engaged, and they understand that hope inspires people to stay in Afghanistan instead of seeking opportunity elsewhere. Afghanistan is at an inflection point, and I believe if we do not make deliberate, measured adjustments, 2016 is at risk of being no better and possibly worse than 2015. To place this into context, I would like to emphasize the uniqueness of 2015 and some dynamics I think we should soberly consider as we assess our way forward. The enemy has also changed this year. Unlike previous years, the Taliban extended the fighting season and has continued to conduct operations in Helmand as called for by the Taliban leadership. Even so, the Taliban recognize that they have no lasting gains to consolidate from last year and cannot afford to cede the limited ground they do hold. They are also coming out of the year that saw fracturing of their organization, competition from other insurgent groups, resulting in loss of legitimacy and high casualty rates, probably their highest casualty rates in years. As I meet with Afghan soldiers and police, I remind them that the Taliban are not 10 feet tall and bulletproof. They face significant challenges, and they can be defeated. The fact is often forgotten in prominent media reports. The brief notoriety the Taliban gained in Kunduz and Helmand is still overshadowed by the significant cost of those efforts, compounded by the loss of credibility and unity as the enemy infighting continues. The Taliban's public narrative in Afghanistan is waning too. It is not lost on the people of Afghanistan that the Taliban are killing Afghans, security forces, and innocent civilians alike. Recent public information campaigns have also been more forceful, stressing to the public that the Taliban have no plan for the development of Afghanistan. The Taliban are here to kill you. The Taliban are against women. The Taliban are against education. And the Taliban are against progress for the nation of Afghanistan. As these messages resonate, the government must show that it is the only viable option for Afghanistan. At the city, district, provincial, and national levels, the people of Afghanistan see that the return of the Taliban represents a return to brutality, criminality, and oppression. The operating environment is also evolving for the Taliban due to the emergence of other insurgent groups and terrorist groups. One such group is Daesh in Afghanistan, or the Islamic State Khorasan Province, ISKP. Daesh continues to conduct brutal attacks against civilians and directly competes with the Taliban for resources to establish a foothold in the country. They have focused their efforts on establishing a presence in Nangarhar and recruiting in other areas. We recently gained the authority to strike Daesh. Since then, we have had considerable success in degrading their capabilities. The rejection of Daesh by local elders who are working with the Afghan security forces has also slowed the enemy's progress. The strikes have been effective in mitigating their growth. We must maintain constant pressure on Daesh and dedicate intelligence resources to prevent strategic surprise. The Taliban has had to adjust to this year's strategy in order to counter the emergence of Daesh and the other insurgent groups. This dynamic has served as a distraction to the Taliban, requiring them to shift precious resources from fighting the Afghan security forces to countering opposition groups. More than just consuming resources, the infighting and resultant inability to maintain cohesion has also severely damaged the credibility of the Taliban's core narrative of being a strong, united organization. Groups aligned with the Taliban, such as Al-Qaeda and the Haqqani network, continue to threaten our national security interests. Al-Qaeda has been significantly weakened, but as evidenced by a recent discovery in Al-Qaeda camp on Afghanistan's southern border, they are certainly not extinct. The Haqqani network remains the most capable threat to the U.S. and coalition forces, planning and executing the most violent high-profile attacks in Kabul. These are certainly not residual threats that would allow for peaceful transition across Afghanistan. Instead, they are persistent threats that are adapting to changing operational environment. Ultimately, the threats Afghanistan faces require our sustained attention and forward presence. Reconciliation is a path needed to obtain a negotiated settlement and end the conflict in Afghanistan. Current reconciliation efforts are an Afghan-led, Afghan-owned initiative. Recently renewed quadrilateral meeting in mid-January included Afghanistan, Pakistan, United States, and China. It has been over a year since the formation of the National Unity Government. It has faced institutional and political difficulties, yet can lay claim to some meaningful reform and progress during its first year. The Unity Government may be fragile, but it is holding, despite being challenged, and it's making continuous progress and building momentum to create an increasingly viable future. Politically, Afghanistan is postured for both progress and continued strategic partnership with the United States. We have a strong and willing partners in President Ghani and Chief Executive Abdullah, and this has not always been the case. So as I said at the beginning of this statement, we now ask ourselves, what else can we do to enable the Afghan security forces? And what else can the Afghans do for themselves to secure their country? A strategic stalemate without end is not the goal of this campaign. Nor is it true to the reason we came here over 14 years ago. In fact, recently submitted NATO strategic assessment makes recommendations for adjustments to the current NATO op plan that my best military advice will help push the campaign past this inflection point and increase the prospect of achieving our shared goals. Measures that NATO is considering include advisory adjustments to give commanders more flexibility on the ground, and shifting from a yearly outlook to a five-year vision to give all donor nations, and especially Afghanistan, the confidence that comes with predictability of support. The United States must continue to show flexibility with our mission in 2016 and beyond. As the commander, I am responsible for aligning our national objectives with ways and means while managing risk. Now that we have been allocated our resources for 2016, I'm assessing the ways in which we ensure that 2016 is not a rerun of 2015. Based on conditions and the performance of the Afghan security forces during this winter lull, I am also reviewing how well those forces will likely perform in 2017 and the U.S. and coalition resources required for their continued development. This is all part of a broader process of which my assessment is only one part. I will provide my assessments of our strategy to my military leadership as well as my successor, McNicholson. I think it is important to remember that this time last year, our plan was to transition to 1,000 troops, Kabul-centric footprint. Due to conditions on the ground, the President made the decision to extend 9,800 through most of 2016 and increased our posture to 5,500 in 2017. This decision proved flexibility to make adjustments and represents the kind of conditions-based approach that is so important for our mission in Afghanistan. Key to this long-term success in the region is the resiliency of the Afghan government and its security institutions, and the ability to serve as a regional partner in our combined efforts to counter violent extremism. It's important to remember that the National Unity Government welcomes our assistance. They are a dependable and steadfast counterterrorism partner in South Asia. 2017 marks a significant change in our approach as we focus our efforts to capitalize on the gains of the past decade and build the capacity at the Afghan security institutions. We now have a window of opportunity to increase our likelihood of achieving strategic success. Of course, our support should not be seen as open-ended, and I believe our approach is sound. This year, we apply greater conditionality to the Afghans in managing the resources we give them. We're also developing a five-year vision out to 2020 to help better define what we are trying to accomplish and avoid a year-to-year mentality. I believe that by changing our and the Afghans' mindset from a cyclic fighting season to fighting season view to a genuine, long-term outlook that best reflects our commitment, we need to provide the Afghans a time and space for them to continue to build their resiliency. Through their spirit and fortitude, they have proven worthy of our continued support. The actions we take now, combined with their resolve to improve, will over time develop a sustainable force capable of securing the nation and in turn help us secure ours. Lieutenant General McNicholson is a good friend of mine. He appeared before this committee last week. I'd urge you to confirm him. He is the best qualified candidate. If I had to pick one man, I would pick McNicholson to replace me. He will do great in Afghanistan. Thank you again for your steadfast support of our campaign, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, General. I think we're in agreement that we don't want a rerun of 2015 and 2016. General Nicholson said that he agreed with my assessment in his hearing last week that the situation conditions in Afghanistan are deteriorating. Do you share that view?
So I said in the opening statement that the situation in Afghanistan is very complex. It has been a very tough year in 2015. We knew it would be. We can't let 15 be like 16. There are things that they can do. They are working on those things that we can do, and we can't have a repeat of 2015. The Taliban have been emboldened by our withdrawal, the lack of close air support the Afghans have had, and so they have had they have fought the Afghan security forces very tough, and we can't let that happen as we move forward. The situation has been a lot harder for them, sir, and we can't let that continue in 16.
I mentioned in my opening statement in our conversations that we should not just focus on numbers, but on missions and capabilities that are required to be provided by United States forces that the Afghans simply are incapable of. In my view, and I believe General Nicholson's view, that 5,500 you'll either be able to carry out the counterterrorism mission or to train, advise, and assist, but not both. Is that your assessment?
Sir, the 5,500 plan was developed primarily around counterterrorism. There's very limited train, advise, and assist in that, in those numbers. To continue to build on the Afghan security forces, the gaps and seams in aviation, logistics, intelligence, as I talked about, we'd have to make some adjustments to that number.
Well, my point is that right now the plan is to go down to 5,500 at the end of 2016. Is that correct?
So that is correct. By 1 January 2017.
So do you think that we will be prepared by the end of 2016 to go down to 5,500, given the requirements for both counterterrorism and train, advise, and assist?
So I've taken a look again at 15 and provided my military leadership with what I believe are adjustments to the number. And as you said, sir, we don't want to talk about number, we want to talk about capabilities. And I think if there are areas that we need to take a look at their capabilities that they lacked in 15.
Yeah, but General, again, are they going to be able to carry out with 5,500 both the counterterrorism mission and the train, advise, and assist mission? Are they going to be able to do that with 5,500 troops? I think that's a pretty straightforward question, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, at 5,500, I believe that they can do the CT mission, the counterterrorism mission, in a very limited train, advise, assist mission.
Will they be able to do both missions adequately with 5,500 troops?
Sir, some of that will depend upon how the Afghan forces continue to make the reforms during the winter lull, how they continue to improve over the summer, and I think we got to continually assess that. If they don't get after the reforms, if some of the assumptions we made
on
5,500
plan... So is it correct for us to plan on 5,500 after the end of 2016?
So right now, you know, my last order is to get to 5,500, and so we're prepared to do
but
that,
do you
but
think
at the same time...
My question is do you think that is appropriate for us to plan on that capability, which we're certainly not sure of today? And your successor stated, with a deteriorating situation in Afghanistan.
Sir, as a commander on the ground, what I believe is that I have to be prepared for all situations. I will prepare for 5,500 to make sure I can follow those orders, but at the same time, based on...
I'm asking for your professional opinion, not whether you can do it or not, whether it is the right thing to do or not.
Sir, I believe the right thing to do is to prepare to go to 5,500 as I am ordered, but at the same time, take a look at conditions on the ground, look at the capabilities as you discussed, sir, not the number, and then provide those adjustments to my military leadership, and then make those adjustments to the capabilities. If we don't have the capabilities, or if the assumptions that we made for the 5,500 plan don't come out true, then of course we have to make those adjustments. And it seems to me those
adjustments
would mean increasing
the number. You can't make those adjustments on the fly. We all know that, General.
So we need to make those decisions early on. We need to make those decisions.
The present situation as it is, does it call for continued either the counterterrorism mission or train, advise, and consent, but not both? Because that's what 5,500 troops give you.
So again, very little TAA on 5,500. Absolutely right.
Are you concerned about the rules of engagement that, for example, I guess that we finally decided to attack ISIS? How long had you known ISIS was there before you got the green light to attack ISIS?
Sir, ISIS KP or Daesh in Afghanistan started forming probably in the January 2015 timeframe.
So that was about a year later we decided that you had permission to strike.
That's correct, sir.
Senator Reid.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And again, thank you, General Campbell, for your service and your testimony. You made the point, but I think it should be emphasized. In order to effectively be prepared for 2016, the decision about force level should be made earlier rather than later. What do you think the optimal sort of time frame is to make that decision, regardless of what it is? The next 2 months, the next 30 days?
Sure. I would. My advice would be to make that decision as early as you could. It would probably be. I would like to see that made before the summer. What that does is really includes NATO. NATO's force generation cycle. They start looking at that in June. So if you want to have NATO part of this, you got to make that call early, so they can force generate. So the forces would be ready to, by 2001 January 2017. Same with our forces. If you make those decisions late, it'd be harder to get the folks trained ready to be there on 1 January 2017.
So given General Nicholson's obligation and commitment to make a very careful review, of which I assume is stressed 30-plus days, he should be ready to make a recommendation early spring, so that the decision should be made early summer.
General Nicholson talked about 90 days. So I'll make sure he has all of my assessments, all everything that I have, a complete transition that will help him move along in his assessment as well.
Regardless of what the decision is, it should be made, in your view, by early summer, say June.
So I would say it is prudent if we make the decision as early as we can. Yes, sir.
Let me also ask about the nature of the changing missions based upon the last year, and I think it's important because the decisions that were made with respect to the current force structure and the projected force structure were made more than a year ago. In that time, the Pakistan military forces have driven considerable number of insurgents, particularly in the Nangarhar province in the east, including al-Qaeda elements. You've also seen the formation in that year of ISKP, which requires, I assume, my last question, a much more vigorous counterterrorism activity than you contemplated a year ago, or the President contemplated a year ago. Is that accurate?
Sir, that'd be accurate, yes, sir.
So in the counterterror mission alone, there is a need for increased capacity. That might not be directly related to numbers, but at least increased capacity. Is that correct?
So I'd rather discuss on CT in a closed hearing,
right,
but in specific numbers and the capability of a CT component. Just suffice to say, we have the very best counterterrorism capability in the entire world. With the additional authorities we received about 2 weeks ago, we have used those with the resources that I currently have. Yes, sir?
Let me another variation on this is that, as you suggested in your testimony, because of the conflict between and fragmentation between the Taliban and ISKP, there's been active combat between those two elements. Is that correct?
Sure, that is correct, especially in Nangarhar province. Right.
And our efforts now were authorized to degrade ISKP could leave a situation where the Taliban has much more flexibility to attack Afghan national security forces. Is that a real possibility?
So we got to balance that. So, yes, sir, that is a possibility.
So it raises the issue of authorities in terms of having the authority to also conduct strikes against against Taliban elements, even though they might not be directly threatening American personnel and force protection. Is that something you're thinking about?
Sure. As I talked about making sure that 2016 is like 2015, as I bend that, you know, you can bend more people, more resources, or more authorities. And so I believe that the authorities piece, I've taken a hard look at, and I have provided recommendations on mitigating and adjusting authorities to my chain of command.
But one of the aspects here is that and you suggested the complexity and the interrelatedness of all of these different decisions, that the decision to go after ISKP proactively raises the issue of whether the Taliban will take advantage unwittingly of our attacks, and that's something we have to also consider. I think that's a point you would agree with.
Yes, sir. And again, sir, the goal is to build the Afghan capacity so they can do this themselves as well, but absolutely.
The other issue in terms of military is the overall requirements to move the Afghan National Security Forces from a static deployment to a much more proactive deployment, and that is something that will require resources in the training assist mission to not only training but also providing enablers so that they can get out of those fixed positions, the checkpoints, et cetera. That adds another sort of capacity requirement in your view?
Sure, it could. I think it really depends on the leadership of the Afghan security forces. They have been trying to reduce checkpoints. In some corps, they've been able to do it okay. In other corps, they haven't done anything. So it is about leadership. And additional train, advise, and assist could potentially provide assistance to them to get after that. This is one of the short-term reforms we're trying to get after during this winter campaign.
And you'll evaluate that, and that'll help inform you and, more appropriately, General Nicholson when he makes a recommendation.
Absolutely, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, General Campbell, and thank you so much for your many years of service to this country and to our people. When we met yesterday, you talked about transitioning the Afghan Army out of a defensive stance into and more of a focus on an offensive action. So I would like to ask, what are the main steps that you see that must be taken in order to accomplish this? You earlier mentioned the capability gaps, and we see that with intelligence, aviation, but that's going to take quite a few years to remedy. And so I'd like to focus on how those gaps relate more to operations. Do you think it's going to take years for the ANSF to move to that defensive stance, and how is that transition going to relate to those capability gaps?
Thank you, Senator, for the question. We've been working on reducing checkpoints, trying to get them more maneuverable for the last year. The focus during the winter, because they saw the result of not doing that during the fighting season of 15, where they had more casualties and they were defensive in nature. I think what they're doing now is identifying key terrain in different provinces and districts to where they absolutely need these combat outposts, and then reduce where they have probably 80% of their force on these type of checkpoints, both in the police and the Army. To get there, they have to do better coordination between the MOI and MOD so that you can't have the police come off one expecting the Army will occupy it, or vice versa, have the Army come off expecting the police. They also have to make sure that there's some sort of political consensus with the governors, with the district governors, because sometimes they're an impediment to making sure that the operating forces can adjust their forces. It's been a continuous struggle where we've worked with them closely and where they have good leadership and understand how important it is to come off of the checkpoints to be more maneuverable. We're starting to gain a little bit of traction. We'll stay with them. How that ties into the capability gaps, they have a finite number of resources, especially in the close air support. So if you get checkpoints all throughout the country, it'll be hard to get those kind of precious resources out there. So they do have to prioritize where they apply their 352,000 Afghan security forces. So moving out of the checkpoints into these key terrain places, I think, will help them. The close air support, Afghan Air Force in general, ma'am, is going to take several more years. It takes about 3 years to build a pilot. So if we pick somebody today, they won't see that pilot for 3 more years. And that's just the human capital aspect. That doesn't include acquiring the platforms, the helicopters, and the fixed wing. They just received 4 of the A-29 Super Toscano fixed wing aircraft about 2 or 3 weeks ago. We'll get another 4 in the April-May timeframe, but that's it for this year. So it's going to take 3 years before they even get all of the equipment for the Air Force, and we'll continue to build upon that.
And how does that affect us in our planning, our strategy? Are you looking at the need to find a solution for all of this? As we look at cutting down troops, how does that all tie in? Because there's a number of operations that are out there. Do we have to fix it all?
And I think for the close air support, again, it's a long-term effort to make sure that they have the right rotary wing and fixed wing support, but that's going to take several years. We do have a current plan. What I've asked to do is another study to take a look at a longer term plan to convert MI-17s, that kind of aircraft, to probably a U.S. aircraft. We're going to need support from this Congress once we get through that, because that is not included in the current financing of the Afghan security forces as we go forward. But the frames that we bought for them, the MI-17s, based on operational losses, op tempo, you know, over the next couple of years, that's going to continue to go down, and we'll have to figure out the life cycle maintenance of probably a different airframe.
And how important is it for the Afghans and also for our allies that are there to maintain the leadership of our country, America's leadership in this area to provide, and again, not just the Afghans, but also our allies, with the certainty that we are committed, and you said this is going to take years. How do we get the message to them that we are committed? They have that certainty when we have discussions about lowering personnel, lowering our troops in the area without regards to what's taking place on the ground.
Yes, ma'am. We have to talk in longer terms. We can't talk cyclic 1 year at a time. I think it begins this year at Warsaw, where we get all the donor nations to commit to long-term for financing of 2018, 2019, 2020. If we can finance it that way, we ought to talk about people, equipment, resources the same way and talk in terms of 5 years. NATO made their decision to continue Resolute Support after the President made our decision to stay at 9,800. As long as the U.S. leads, then I think NATO will continue to be there with us. Now that they are going to be with us into 2017, as I talked about adjustments, the 5,500 number did not include really support to NATO. So again, that's one of the adjustments I've taken a look at since that decision was made, and have provided those adjustments that I said we have to make on that 5,500 capability as we move forward.
And we're seeing support of our NATO allies when they know that we are going to be there and lead. Do we also see support with the Afghan people?
Ma'am, I talked to NATO right after the October decision. They're absolutely on board. All the countries continue to support in 16. Many have already committed for 17. So again, I think they understand that NATO, this is NATO's largest mission, NATO's longest operation they've ever had in their history. They want it to be successful. If we continue to lead, NATO will be there. As far as the Afghan people, you know, every survey, every time I talk to Afghans, overwhelmingly understand that to continue to build their Afghan security forces for a secure country, they're going to need our support, and they overwhelmingly want that.
Thank you, General.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, General Campbell, for your service. And this country certainly owes a debt of gratitude to you and your family for what you have done. And I wish you much success in whatever you decide to do next. I want to continue the conversation you were just having with Senator Fisher, because I think your point in your testimony about the need to provide a long-term commitment to Afghanistan that people can count on, so they don't feel like we're going to be leaving at the end of each year, is very important. Do you, when you talk about the support from the international community and NATO, have they continued to make the financial contributions that they have committed to for Afghanistan? And are they, have you spoken with them about their willingness to commit to a 5-year plan for the country?
Ma'am, I raised a 5-year issue. General Breedlove raised it at the last Chief of Defense conference a couple weeks ago. It'll go ahead to the Ministers of Defense of all the countries next week. And I think based on what I saw from the CHOD conference, there should be pretty good support as we move forward. I think they're absolutely for that. It gives them the ability to plan, to resource. You know, again, any budget 1 year at a time is very, very hard to do. So I think NATO is completely on board with that. All the countries continue to provide the assistance that they pledged at the Chicago 2012 conference. Again, the United States is the biggest contributor, but the NATO countries continue to provide and have done so. And I think if we talk in terms of a long-term commitment, it does a couple things. It gives confidence to the Afghan government, to the national government, to the Afghan people, to the Afghan security forces. It sends a message to Pakistan. It sends a message to the Taliban. And it sends a message to NATO. So, again, long-term commitment, talking those kind of terms, conditions based on the ground, is the way we need to move forward to enable the Afghans to have predictability and stability. A lot of reason you see a lot of the refugees leaving out of Afghanistan this year is because of the instability. Security, of course, but again, the instability of thinking people are going to leave year after year after year.
So just to be clear, they are current in financial obligations that have been made.
The countries have, yes, ma'am, and Afghanistan, based on the Chicago conference, pledged $500 million a year toward the security forces.
Great.
And they have met that, and they want to continue to bring that up.
Thank you. Earlier this week, there were reports of several airstrikes that destroyed a radio station that was operated by ISIS near the border with Pakistan. And obviously, the radio station is assumed to be broadcasting extremist messages. I was interested in your comments about the efforts of the central government to, I don't want to call it propaganda, but to point out the differences to the Afghan people between the work of the central government and what they're seeing from the Taliban, and I assume from ISIS. So first I want to ask, do the people of Afghanistan distinguish between the Taliban and ISIS? And as you say, this battle is really as much as about the hearts and minds of the Afghan people as it is about the military conflict. And to what extent is there support for what the central government is doing in trying to point out to the people of the country the differences between the Taliban and what the central government is proposing, and how much are we helping in that effort?
Thank you, ma'am, for the question. Absolutely, the Afghan people understand and see the difference between Taliban and Daesh or ISIL, and they understand that ISIL has been very brutal. All the countries in the region absolutely understand that ISIL has been very brutal and have talked to Afghanistan about what they can help fight this regional piece about ISIL. And President Ghani looks at it not as an Afghan problem, but as a regional and actually a global piece, and that everybody has to stand up for it. As far as providing confidence to the people, I think it depends upon what part of the country, what district you're in, what leadership is out there. If you have good district governors, he has good people in his staff. They provide what the people want. They care for them. Then they absolutely believe that the national government is supporting them. Other places that they don't have that, and all you have is the Taliban, and the Taliban provides some sort of support to them, then they're going to believe the Taliban. But again, people want the same things we want here. They want their kids to go to school. The Taliban don't believe in that. They want folks to have a job, to have a roof over their heads, on and on. So overwhelmingly, they don't want to go back to Taliban days. But if they don't have support from the government at the lowest levels, they're going to make the choice to go with whoever is supporting them. The national government knows it has to do a better job in getting out and being with the people. President Ghani was just in Kandahar yesterday. He is getting out now to all the different provinces to really meet with the leadership. And he's doing another thing by taking the ulama, or the religious leaders as well, and making sure that they're tied into it, because they absolutely can help get the right message across about what the government is trying to do and how bad the Taliban is.
And I know my time has expired, Mr. Chairman, but if I could just ask him to follow up on the other part of my question, which is, are we contributing at all in terms of direct assistance to a counter ISIL, a counter Taliban message to the people of Afghanistan that's organized?
Ma'am, I can give you that in a closed hearing, if I can provide that to you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. That would be helpful.
Thank you, Chairman. General Campbell, I want to thank you for your distinguished service to the country and for your leadership. You've done an excellent job, and I wish you the best going forward, and I want to thank your family as well. We're very proud of you. I wanted to follow up on the questions that Chairman McCain asked you about the drop in troop levels in Afghanistan to 5,500. As I understand your answer, this will enable very little train, advise, and assist, and will be focused on a CT function in Afghanistan. And my question to you is, if that decision in fact stands and that's where we remain, what risks do we incur by going in that direction? Especially as I heard your testimony based on what happened in 2015 in Afghanistan.
Thank you, ma'am, for the question. Again, the 5,500 number was primarily built around a CT structure. And as we've taken a look at that decision and what's changed on the ground, elections are going to happen potentially in October. That was not considered. Assumptions that the Afghan security forces should provide other things to support that number. If they don't make some of the reforms, then General Nicholson will absolutely have to come forward and said, this assumption did not prove true, therefore we need X. So right now, what we're counting on is the Afghans will make necessary reforms that will complement and enable us to be at that capability in that number. But if they don't, as I said before, I've already looked at and provided the military chain of command ways that we can make adjustments to the capabilities that Senator McCain talked about that we're going to absolutely need.
So I just
very limited TAA at that number. Yes, ma'am.
So I want to understand, just so the American people understand, what are the risks there then? If all this doesn't work out perfectly and we still yet go to that number, what kind of risks do we face on the ground that are risks to our interests?
The risk would be that the Afghan security forces will not be able to make the necessary adjustments and improve as we thought that they could. And it would take them much longer, and it would be a much harder fight against the insurgents in 2016 and 17.
And would that also provide more safe haven for, obviously, potential extremist groups and, obviously, the Taliban's reinsurgence?
It could, yes, ma'am.
I wanted to also ask you, you talked about the NATO commitment, and I think you said that NATO will follow us. So if we do cut in half what we have in Afghanistan, what do you expect our NATO partners would do?
Again, ma'am, under the 5,500 number, when that plan was developed and the President made that decision, NATO had not made their decision yet. NATO made their decision after the 5,500 number, probably in the December timeframe, to continue the Resolute Support mission into 2017. I believe NATO absolutely would welcome and needs U.S. to continue to have the lead, and we actually provide some resources to our NATO partners, both in the north and the west.
But do you agree with me? If we go down, NATO's going to, I mean, they're going to diminish too, or at some point get out of this operation.
Yeah, if our number continues to go down, NATO will absolutely reduce their commitment in Afghanistan. I believe that is true.
So, Iran, I wanted to ask you to describe for us what Iran's activities are in Afghanistan right now, and also describe for us what activities they are undertaking that concern you.
Ma'am, I think, you know, what Afghanistan is trying to do is have a sovereign country to sovereign country relationship with their neighbor to the west, Iran. Dr. Abdullah was just there about 2 weeks ago trying to work through that piece of it. I am concerned that Iran has provided a support to the Taliban in order for the Taliban to fight ISIL or Daesh. They are worried about ISIL or Daesh, so they have provided support to the Taliban. And I'm worried that support that they provide to the Taliban could be used against the Afghan security forces.
Are you worried at some point that Iran's territory could be used as a potential safe haven, as well as we've seen in Pakistan for the Taliban?
I think that's a possibility, yes, ma'am. And I think we got to do everything we can to make sure that doesn't happen.
Thank you, General.
We are two. I'd very much like to move the nomination of Lieutenant General Nicholson. There, we are two senators short of the required quorum. I would ask one short, who I understand is on his way. I would ask unanimous consent, since we're only one short, to waive the rules and ask the committee to consider the nomination of Lieutenant General John W. Nicholson, Jr. to be General and Commander Resolute Support and Commander United States Forces Afghanistan. His nomination has been before the committee the required time. If there's an objection to the one short of the quorum, I'll be glad to withdraw that. Hearing none, then, is there a motion to so favorably report Lieutenant General Nicholson's nomination to the Senate?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
The motion carries. Thank you. Senator Blumenthal.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, thank you for your service in Afghanistan.
Could I just, Senator Donald, you are in favor of the nomination of General Nicholson.
If you say so, sir, I
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, thank you for your service to our nation in this job and many previous assignments, and your distinction in providing insightful and deliberate testimony to this committee. You have said, I think, in the past that 70% of Afghanistan's military problems are related to weak political leadership. I may be misstating or exaggerating, but my question is directed to less the technical strength or viability of the military capacity of the country and more to the effectiveness and reliability of the political leadership. In your view, is Afghanistan's political leadership up to the job?
So if I can just say about the 70% I was referring to, military leadership, 70% of the problems they have in the MOI and the MOD is based on the leadership they have there. And if they pick the right leaders and they hold them accountable, that'll take care of many of their issues. So your question on the political piece, and again, I
stand corrected, and I apologize.
I understand, sir. On the whether or not President Ghani, Dr. Abdul, I think you're asking, sir, the national union government, it is viable. Can it govern as we move forward? So it survived the last 15, 16 months in a very, very tough fighting season where Afghanistan was fighting for its survival. It survived President Ghani reaching out to Pakistan to try to change the dynamics on the ground in that relationship. It sustained opposition like President Karzai doing different things out there. So it's been a rough road. We shouldn't make light of that, sir. But President Ghani and Dr. Abdullah, on the big policy issues, I believe there's no daylight between them, and they continue to work very hard because they understand how important it is for the future of Afghanistan, and they know there's no other viable option. When it comes to picking governors, ministers, other folks, and I really do think it's the people around the president, people around Dr. Abdullah, that are stirring up the waters. And again, I see both Dr. Abdullah, President Ghani, many times a week, and they are a great partner, and they understand how and they value their foundational partner is the United States. And I think we have to continue to work with them. They understand the issues and challenges they have to work on. But it's going to take them a while to do that, sir. And I think we just got to continue to provide the assistance we can to help them move that forward.
And you'd agree that as we saw in Iraq, an inclusive and effective government in Afghanistan is essential to military success.
Sure, absolutely. I mean, there's no comparison between what you had in Iraq with Maliki and then what you have in Afghanistan today with the national government.
On the issue of political relationships, I want to mention Pakistan. Are you satisfied with progress that has been made, if there has been progress, in combating the flow of both militants and munitions across the border from Pakistan?
So when I think about Pakistan, I think about both political issues, economic issues. I most deal with the military-to-military issues and make sure that the Pak Army and the Afghan Army continue to talk core-to-core, and they talk those kind of issues. So they understand that they have to continue to do that, to fight this enemy that knows no borders. And that it's good for both of them to continue to develop that relationship. And if they're not talking, they're not going to go anywhere. I am concerned about what is going across, both from Pakistan into Afghanistan, and quite frankly, as General Raheel has talked to me about, the chief of the Pakistan Army, potential stuff going from Afghanistan into Pakistan, as they believe happened a couple weeks ago on a school attack there. So I think the more mill-to-mill they can work together to improve discussion between core to core, what goes on between that very open border, that it only get better. But I am concerned about what's going across. Yes, sir.
And my time has expired, but I thank you very much. Thank you.
General, thank you and your whole team. I've had the pleasure to meet most of your folks over there, and I think you can look back on your time and say well done. You kept Afghanistan together, and it's not Iraq. And let's talk about that for a second. Kunduz, when the Taliban came in and dislodged the police and the security forces, the town was retaken by the Afghans. Is that correct?
Sure, that is correct.
There's a big difference between Kunduz, Mosul, and Ramadi.
Sure, absolutely. I mean, the fortitude and resilience of the Afghan forces to get back and take over a town of 300,000 in a very short time was pretty remarkable.
If we had no U.S. troops there, how hard would it have been to accomplish that task?
Sir, in my estimation, it would have taken a lot longer to be able to do that.
Right now, this moment, if you had to tell this committee, should we stay at 9,800 based on what you know right now, this moment, for the rest of the year and into next year, what would you say?
Sir, then I would be violating what Senator McCain told me to talk about capabilities, sir. And again, sir, what I've done...
You're not bound by that.
So what I'm telling you is at the 5,500, I am glad we're at 5,500, sir. We're in a much better place than we were.
You mean the 9,800?
5,500. We're at 98 now, yes, sir. So we're in a much better place than we were. And I'm very glad that we're there. But as we look at going down to 5,500, I've got to manage it. I want to keep 9,800 as long as I can in 2016 before I have to drop to 5,500. To do that after the fighting season between the October, November, December timeframe is going to be very, very difficult. But I have to figure out a way, and I'll pass
it. Is the 5,500 a military goal or a political goal?
So the 5,500 was a number based on certain assumptions and mission sets that were required to accomplish.
If I ask you right now, do you think we should be at 5,500 at the end of the year? Is that a good military thing?
So I would have to base it on conditions on the ground.
Yeah, but you want to do counterterrorism, right?
Yes, sir.
So 5,500 is mostly counterterrorism-centric.
It's most CT. It has limited TAA.
You just described a Senator Fisher tremendous gaps in the air capability of the Afghans. You've talked about 2015 being tough. I just don't see where the 5,500. Did the military recommend 5,500, or was this just a number picked by the White House?
Sure, that was part of a long process that the military was tied into. Yes, sir.
I mean, my question is, did the military say we think based on everything we know about Afghanistan, 5,500 is the right number? Did that come from the politicians in the White House?
So I don't believe that came from the politicians. That was an overall process.
What general recommended 5,500?
So I don't want to go into, discussions.
I just want to know where this number came from. I want to know, is it a politically driven number or is it a military driven number?
So I think it's a number driven based on the mission sets, the narrow mission sets of TAA, limited as I talked about, and a CT mission. But again, there were assumptions made, as every course of action, there are assumptions made, and if those assumptions don't prove true,
did the military suggest we just do two things in Afghanistan, counterterrorism, train, advise, and assist, or did that come from the political leadership?
Sure, the military has an opportunity to provide their best military advice on the purpose of why we're there, the mission sets that are assigned.
The only reason I mention this is that we're in Iraq in a state of disarray. I've been hearing for a long time that it was the Iraqis who said no to residual forces. I don't believe that for a moment. I know what the military recommended to the White House, and I know why we got to zero. The same people that pushed us to zero, I think, are pushing us to 5,500. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe 5,500 is the best military configuration at the end of 2016. I just have real serious doubts about that. Am I wrong to doubt that?
Sure, as I said, I've already provided what I think are adjustments to that number based on the capabilities that will be required to move forward.
Is the Taliban an enemy of this country?
I didn't hear the question, sir.
Is the Taliban an enemy of the United States?
The Taliban, as far as helping al-Qaeda and Haqqani and other insurgent groups, Taliban have been responsible for many,
many
years.
If the Taliban were in charge of Afghanistan tomorrow, would our homeland be threatened?
So I think it would be more at risk.
Are you prohibited from attacking senior leadership of the Taliban?
So I have all the authorities I need to protect our coalition.
Can you attack the senior leadership of the Taliban?
So if there's senior leadership of the Taliban that are attacking...
I'm not talking about force protection. I'm talking about, can you go after the Taliban who are trying to take over the country of Afghanistan that would invite terrorists back into that region to attack us? Can you attack the Taliban?
So I believe if the Taliban are a threat to us, I can attack them. If I cannot attack Taliban...
Without shooting at a soldier, can you attack them? If they're not shooting at one of our soldiers, can you attack them?
So I have to make the force protection nexus to the Taliban.
So our limitations on the Taliban is that they got to have a direct threat to the U.S. forces, right?
Sure, again, I don't go into rules of engagement authorities in open hearing. What I would tell you is that our country has made the decision that we are not at war with the Taliban.
Do you think we're at war with the Taliban?
I think the Taliban have killed many of my soldiers.
Do you think they're at war with us?
So the Taliban continue to...
You think the Taliban would welcome an attack on the United States if they could help make one happen?
I do, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In general, thank you for everything you've done for our country. We are really in your debt. When the 9800 level was set, in light of the things that have happened on the ground, push here, push there, those kind of things, does the 9800 level being there, when you set that number, did you anticipate things like this would happen? I mean, has that number in your mind needed to be adjusted because of what's happened, or do you think it's sufficient to meet the challenges that you deal with every day?
Sure, the 9800 number was already determined before I got there.
Right.
Right. So, and we were going down to 1,000 when I got there. And we had no CT capability at 1,000. We were Kabul-centric. Today, we have a CT mission and the ability to work that mission, and we're not Kabul-centric. So I think we have great flexibility as we move forward because of the decisions that have been made. The 5,500 number, as I've said several times today in testimony, is I have made my recommendations to adjustments on the capabilities that are required based on what we learned in 2015. And the 5,500 number is primarily focused on CT. If the Afghans cannot improve, we're going to have to make some adjustments, and that means that number will most likely go up. So, yes, sir.
When you look at the situation and make a judgment, what are the things that worry you the most as you look at what lies ahead?
So always number one in my mind is force protection of our men and women, to make sure that we have all the resources, the authorities to be able to protect them. And whether they're sitting at Bagram or whether they're sitting in Kabul or whether they're doing expedition advising on another combat outpost someplace in Afghanistan. So that's number one. Number two is I want to make sure that we continue, or I worry about the Afghans not putting the right leadership and having a sense of urgency to continue to move forward. They've made so many gains, they've done so well over the last 14 years to get to where they're at, that if they don't do some of the things here because of how long it's taken, they'll lose the confidence of the donor nations, and if they don't have the money, then they can't move forward. They absolutely need to have the continued support of the coalition and the nations to provide the funding. They will not have the funding. Their economy will not be able to support, by all the reports I've seen, without any help, till about 2024. We're looking at the Warsaw to get them through 2020. But again, President Ghani is doing everything he can to build upon a regional peace to get their economy going. So I worry about our force protection. I worry about them being able to continue to make progress without other nations losing confidence and abandoning them.
When you look at Afghanistan and some of the challenges with the Taliban have been in the more rural or outlying areas where they've had an outsized influence, is it that the people in those areas are more accepting of the Taliban, or they just don't have the ability to push back as much?
So I think it's probably a little bit both, but probably more the latter, that you know they would like to push back, but if they don't have the police, the army, to be able to support them in those areas, the Taliban threatens them. In some areas, they stand up. They do a great job. That's where we get Afghan local police, and they work through that. But in other areas, you know, they want to continue to survive, and the Taliban put that pressure on them.
When you look at the Taliban, what are the biggest advantages that they bring to the fight on their side, and what's our best way to counter that?
So again, the Taliban, what they've done well is they've the Afghan people, or really the Afghan security forces, and the first time I've seen it, and that's why I said the Taliban can be beaten. They're not 10 feet tall. But in many areas, their propaganda, their information ops have convinced many of the security forces that they can beat them. They can't. They're not manned. They're not equipped. They're not trained. The advantage they have is They don't follow any rules. They can kill civilians. They can target whoever they want to target. They can put out little IEDs out there that just kill indiscriminately. So that's what they do. I mean, they're terrorists. And so that's how they take advantage. They put fear in the hearts of the people. The Afghan security forces are like any of our other militaries that we want. They have to abide by rules. They have to watch out for civilian casualties. They have discipline. The Taliban don't have any of that. They offer nothing to the future of Afghanistan.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
General Campbell, it's good to see you again for this committee, for the last time, it would appear. Thank you for your service, not just in Afghanistan, but your service for many years in uniform. You've certainly earned the right to drop the rucksack and ask someone else to pick it up now. I want to return to a topic that Senator Graham was addressing. You said, quote, our country is not at war with the Taliban, end quote. People have to make decisions for countries. Is that a decision that was made by the Commander-in-Chief that our country is no longer at war with the Taliban?
So that's a policy decision.
Okay. But when you were asked if the Taliban would attack the United States today, if they could, you answered, I do. That's correct?
So they're attacking forces in Afghanistan. And again, the network in Afghanistan where you get Haqqani, Al-Qaeda, LET, it's all intermingled. And we know for sure that ISIL, we know for sure that AQ and some of its remnants have already attacked the U.S. and want to continue to have vision on doing that. So the Taliban support that in other ways, yes, sir.
Okay. In your opening statement, you indicated that newly authorized airstrikes against the Islamic State in Afghanistan have been effective in slowing their growth. Would you expect the use of U.S. air power against the Taliban to have similar effect on the Taliban's progress in the country if you used air power against the Taliban?
Sir, again, I'm trying to build the Afghan capability to do that. But as I take a look at adjustments that need to be made, authorities is one of those for 2016. And as I said up front, I have provided my leadership some mitigating efforts that I think will improve the Afghan forces and their probability of success against the Taliban as we move forward. Yes, sir.
As you were suggesting to Senator Graham about responding to the Taliban if they're attacking coalition forces, David Petraeus wrote in the Washington Post approximately 3 weeks ago that air power currently is used only one to attack validated al-Qaeda targets, two to counter specific individuals or groups who have attacked coalition forces previously, and three to respond directly to attacks on coalition forces. According to leaders on the ground, U.S. and NATO forces are not otherwise allowed to attack Taliban targets. Do you think the lack of U.S. air power being employed against the Taliban accounts for some of their gains in the country?
I think the Taliban know that we downsized. I think the Taliban understand that in the past they couldn't gather in larger formations. I think we've seen this year that they have taken advantage of the reduction of the number of coalition aircraft. Absolutely.
Thank you. I want to turn now to the attacks in Helmand Province on January 5th, in which Army Staff Sergeant Matthew McClintock died. There's been some reporting in the media that the Quick Reaction Force was not allowed to deploy rapidly and that an AC-130 gunship was in the air and was not allowed to engage during the firefight. I'm sure you're up to speed on this event. Would you care to share with the committee your thoughts on what happened that evening?
So that's under investigation right now, and as you know, when investigation is ongoing, we don't discuss it. What I would tell you is that we'll do everything to provide force protection. I've said that's number one utmost in my mind, and we'll make sure whenever we employ our forces, and they were in a train, advise, and assist role with the Afghan Special Operating Forces, that we have all the necessary resources required to reduce the threat to them. I mean, whenever we send folks out, there is a CONOP process that goes forward to make sure that we have the right medevac, we have the right quick reaction force, on and on and on. So this investigation will find out what exactly happened on that, and I need to hold off on that until that investigation is brought forward to me.
Are the restrictions that you face, both on the resources available to you and the way you employ those resources, potentially at play in what happened in Marja that evening?
So again, I have no restrictions on providing force protection.
Well, you only have 9,800 troops there, right?
We're authorized 9,800, yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. If you were to reduce from 9,800 to 5,500 or even lower than that, Might we be more likely to see something like this happen once again in the future because the next commander, General Nicholson, is constrained in the resources he has and the way he can employ those resources?
Sir, there is no restraint on force protection. So I think General Nicholson, before he would allow soldiers to go out and do a train, advise, assist mission with the special operating forces, he and the commanders on the ground would make sure they had all the necessary requirements there to do that, as they did, I'm sure, in this case here. So, I don't see the tie between that number.
The way the restraint might play out then is a limitation on the kind of missions they can conduct if they don't have the resources to support the force protection and the CASAVEC for those missions. Is that fair to say?
What's fair to say is I would not let them go out on a mission unless we had the right CASAVEC, unless we had the right quick reaction force. Yes, sir.
Which necessarily means that some missions may not be able to be accomplished.
We work within the resources we have. Yes, sir.
Well, thank you very much again for your service. I know you've been a commanding general of the Screaming Eagles. It came to our attention at his confirmation hearing that General Nicholson had never served there. He'd only served in the 82nd. I hope that he can overcome this deficiency in his background, but I do understand he once served under 101st headquarters in Afghanistan. So maybe if you leave a combat patch in your desk, he'll hit the ground running.
Sir, I'll do that. I also have 3 tours in the 82nd, sir, so I got a great affinity for the 82nd.
But you capped it off at the 101st Air Assault.
I did. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, Senator Cotton, for that summary of General Campbell's career. We appreciate it very much. Senator King.
General Campbell, you had a narrow escape a few minutes ago when the chairman asked for unanimous consent to move that nomination. I almost objected, not because of any reservations about General Nicholson, but about my extreme admiration for you and my desire to keep you there. I'm thinking of introducing a resolution forbidding your retirement, but...
Sir, you'll have to deal with Mrs. Campbell.
Yeah, so thank you.
That's all I'd say.
I appreciate that. We've been talking around an issue today that's really troubling to me. I can't understand any good reason to announce in advance to an enemy that you're going to reduce your troop levels. I just can't. If I were the Taliban, I'd say, okay, fellas, let's go to Acapulco for 6 months and we'll come back in the fall when the Americans are no longer going to be doing anything but counterterrorism. Help me with this. But first, and you've been very diplomatic this morning, but first, isn't it true that in order to go to the 5,500, which is a fundamental change of mission, as you've testified this morning, it's a change of mission from train and assistant and counterterrorism to almost entirely counterterrorism. When does that change of that qualitative change have to start? It's not January 1st of 2017. Isn't it sometime late this summer, early fall?
Sure, again, that becomes physics at some point in time on how you can move forces out responsibly and safely. And I would like to keep, my recommendation, General Nicholson, will be to keep 9,800 as long as you can during the most violent part of the fighting season, which is the summer. So probably in the October timeframe, they'd have to really work hard to make sure they got down to the right number if they continue on the path to go to 5,500.
You've been so diplomatic in your testimony this morning, but in your professional military opinion, does it make any sense to announce to an enemy that you're going to reduce your not only your troop level, but your mission, particularly as it pertains to them, in advance? I do understand trying to motivate the Afghans to understand that they can't rely on us forever. That's the one policy I do understand. But it's countervailed, it seems to me, by the signal it sends to the enemy that all they've got to do is wait for 6 or 8 months or a year.
That's right. This is a policy decision, not a military decision.
But I'm asking you, as a military man, as a general, you would not put a bulletin out the day before a battle saying, we're going to fight you guys like hell until midnight, but then we're going to withdraw our troops.
So any military leader would want to keep all the advantage to him and not provide any advantage to the enemy.
I'll take that as a...
So I'm not trying to be diplomatic.
No, I understand.
What I'm trying to tell you is that, any guy on the ground, any military commander is going to want to have as many resources as he can, as many soldiers as he can, and he's going to want to accomplish a mission. But at the same time, what I'm trying to do here, and I'm not trying to be disrespectful, what I'm trying to do is make sure that I provide my military leadership the opportunity to make those judgments and pass that to our political leadership and not debate it in open, because I think that hurts us as well. And I think that that gives the enemy an advantage and not advantage. And what I'm trying to say, just as Senator McCain said, it isn't about numbers. It is about the capability. And right now, where we were to where we are, with Bagram, Jalalabad, Kandahar.
We're way ahead of where we were a year ago.
We have options now, and I think we ought to take advantage of those options as we move forward.
I completely agree. I'm, as you can tell, I have real reservations about the policy. But
announcing numbers provides the enemy, maybe in their mind, that they can wait us out.
Bingo. Close air support. One of the asymmetric advantages we have is air power, and you testified this morning about the limitations on Afghan air power and how long it's going to take. Wouldn't it make sense for us to maintain, forget about all the other missions we're talking about, but to maintain a close air support capability without the limitations necessarily that we have now for some longer period of time, wouldn't that be a tremendous advantage to the Afghan security forces?
So you can give me all the resources you want and all the people. If you don't have the authorities, you got a mismatch. Or you can have all the authorities you want if you don't have the right resources. So you got to have that balance, absolutely.
But I'm talking about resources and authorities. That what I'm asking is, close air support would be a significant advantage to the Afghan security forces if we had the resources and the authority.
Sure, the close air support has been the one resource and the capability that the Afghans have asked me for every single day. And again, a couple years ago, 150 attack helicopters, two squadrons, Air Force. When we started Resolute Support, they were down to 5 Mi-35s. They have zero at the end of the fighting season. They just picked up 3 because India passed those on to them. That'll really help. But yeah, they desire that. We would have to work TTPs, have the right authorities to provide the right assistance on the ground for them. But
I would hope that in your final recommendations, as your exit interview, if you will, that you would emphasize the importance of that.
I absolutely will.
Thank you. Thank you again for your service, General.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, thank you for your service, and thank you to your family for sticking with you and working through this marvelous career, and at the same time, all of the sacrifice that you've made is most certainly a sacrifice which they have endured with you, and I appreciate that. General, last time that you were here, we had asked you for some specific responses to what had happened in Kunduz with the very unfortunate incident where a hospital was attacked. I want to thank you for having, in a timely fashion, to having responded to our request and providing a very good answer to our questions. It is appreciated. Also, I know that you've already talked about this somewhat with Senator Blumenthal, but I'd like to give you the opportunity to perhaps specifically work in with regard to governance and the challenges there. We know that ultimately effective governance will be required for the counterinsurgency effort to succeed. To what extent has effective governance evolved during your time in Afghanistan, and how do you see the relationship between the effective governance and the U.S. troop level that should remain? And let me preface the question with this. In October, when we came and you had the opportunity to show us kind of what you were doing and how you were working with this government, this unity government, it was at the same time that the announcement was that we would maintain 10,000 and eventually have to come down to 5,500. But I got the impression that it was because of the governance and the capabilities that were there that we were even considering doing that. And yet at the same time, it seemed to be reported that this was there because of the incompetence of the Afghans rather than because we could see progress being made. I'd like you to have the opportunity to comment on that and get your thoughts.
Sure. Thanks for the question. You know, several years ago when I was there before, sure, we had provincial reconstruction team, PRTs. We had an influx of civilians that would help at district levels, and we had prioritized districts. And we tried to help build the Afghan capability all the way down the district level. And you could see the services that were provided to the people of those districts and provinces continue to rise. We've gone away from PRTs over the last several years, as we believe that the Afghans could pick that up themselves. For me, again, even on the governance side, it's about leadership. It's about having the right people in the right position and giving them the authority and then holding them accountable. President Ghani and Dr. Abdullah are trying to do that. You know, it starts with governors of the 34 provinces and picking the right folks there. Then it goes down to the 407-plus districts and have the right people there. If you have the right people and you don't fill out the staffs, they don't have the budget. I mean, it's a hard process. But I do see them getting after it. I sit right next to the I go to the National Security Council meetings with that President Ghani allows me to go to once a week, 3 or 4 hours at a chunk. Right next to me is the IDLG, which is works through all the governance. He and I have many conversations as he tries to work after getting the right people in place to really start that. They reach out to many other countries to help them in different ways, to have programs that help build their governance capability. From a military standpoint, all I do really, sir, is work to help build the security forces so they can provide security down in those districts that would embolden the governance to take shape.
General, right now you have the option of maintaining 9,800 or so troops. And I know that you have a responsibility. You've been directed that you must get that down to approximately 5,500 by the end of the year. If the current plan is allowed in place, how long can you maintain the adequate levels for both the counterinsurgency and the training mission, which I know you believe in? How long can you maintain the higher number until you have to start drawing down in order to meet the obligation that you've been given?
Sure, we're working through, and we'll have very detailed plans to show that glide slope, but my opinion right now is I'm going to try to keep 9,800. I recommend to General Nicholson to keep 9,800 all the way through most of the fighting season, but at some point, as I said before, it becomes physics, and you have to get people out of different areas and bring them in, and that's we've done that over the years from 100,000-plus to where we are today, so we have a very methodical, well-thought-out process, and our logisticians are the best in the world to be able to get that done.
But your goal is to maintain as many as possible for as long as possible, just in case there may be a change in heart with regard to what we need there. Would that be fair to say, sir?
I'm going to try to keep as many as I can, as long as I can, but understand I have an order to get down to the...
Yes, sir, and I appreciate that. Thank you once again for your service and for your answers today, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I add my thanks, General, to you and your family for your years of service to our country. In the series of questions and your responses regarding what is the appropriate number of U.S. forces in Afghanistan, part of the assessment from your testimony is that we need to assess the capability of the Afghani military to protect themselves. So I know that in your testimony that you assess that at least 70% of the problems facing the Afghan security forces results from poor leadership, and that there's some positive changes occurring with regard to replacing the poor leadership, which I assume is poor leadership in the Afghan military. That's what you're referring to, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Military. So the Army has replaced 92 general officers, which I assume is a positive change that was made.
And for the most part, those are all very positive changes. That's happened just probably in the last 3 months.
So I don't know out of how many general officers, how many more general officers do you think needs to be replaced in order to strengthen the capability of the Afghan Army?
Ma'am, on the MOD side, on the Army side, I think we're down to very few. There's a couple key positions that the Minister of Defense has taken a look at that I know that he wants to change out, and that I would concur with him.
Although
we got to get to the MOI side, on the police side, we have not made very many changes on the police side. I think that's really where we have to go next.
So that's what you're referring to when you said these changes will take time. It's on the police side, military police side.
Yes, ma'am.
Not necessarily.
I mean, the future of both the Army and the police are the great young leaders they have today, the captains, majors. They're building their non-commissioned officer corps. They have folks that have been trained in the U.S., the U.K., Germany, other places. We got to continue to put them in the right leadership positions. And again, I think that's the hope. That's the future of their security force.
So what kind of factors will need to be in place to ensure that these kinds of leadership changes continue to occur in Afghanistan?
Ma'am, you have to have leaders of courage that want to make those decisions based on merit, based on standards, not based on patronage. You have that in the national government.
So you need political leaders with that kind of perspective as well as military leaders.
You do, ma'am, because the general officers for sure the 2, 3, and 4 stars are picked by the political leadership. And below the 1 star, it really is with inside the Ministry of Defense, but that's also political leadership.
So since the changing leadership is such a critical part of assessing, is going to have an impact on what would be an appropriate number of U.S. forces, what is the length of time do you see of that would be necessary for these kinds of changes to occur in Afghanistan?
Ma'am, I would hope that they would make all the critical ones prior to this summer fighting season so they can get those in place and have a better opportunity to change the dynamic of 16 versus 15. So I would hope they could make most of those here very, very quickly.
So that's very positive. I know that we use turning to conditionalities when it comes to the distribution of our aid and resources in Afghanistan. One of the areas of conditionality involves women's rights in Afghanistan. What progress has the Afghan government made with regard to women's rights? Can you express your thoughts on that?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for the question. They're doing much better in the MOI and the police than they are in the Army. They're working both, but there's institutional challenges on the Army side to recruit women because the Army is a national force, and I think the women want to join and stay where they grew up. The police, they can do that. The Army, they usually can't, so they're working around that. They've done, actually, again, quite good on police side of encouraging women to join, sending them to Jordan and other Turkey to get schooling and then bring them back in. The money that has been appropriated from our Congress specifically towards women issues, I think, has encouraged many to continue to join. And what we'll continue to push. Our President Ghani has talked about this. Dr. Abdul has talked about it. They just have to continue to implement.
So do you think we should increase the direct funding that we provide to the women who want to be a part of what Afghanistan needs to do?
And I think right now we're very good on where we're at on the funding, and I think the numbers that we're at are fine for where we're at. I think what we've done differently here the last year or so is in the past we would take that money and say, hey, they need this or they need that, not really understanding what the women of Afghanistan really needed. And now what we've done is bring them into the process. We have a women's advisory committee that I chair along with Ms. Ghani that helps us determine some of those pieces. But we take their feedback more now, which makes us be more efficient with the money we have.
That makes a lot of sense. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, thank you for being here for your service. I have to say that when I visited Afghanistan last year, I came away inspired by the morale on the ground and by their utmost confidence in your leadership and the leadership of your team. So thank you. A quick question. I know you've been pummeled on the troop levels. Can you at least concur that at the time the decision was made to go to a Kabul-centric 1,000-person footprint, that in no way reflected the force needs that we had and based on the conditions on the ground?
So I don't know when the 1,000 Kabul-centric was made, to tell you the truth. I wasn't there.
But when the policy decision was made, I mean, can you imagine any time, whether you were there or not, that made sense based on the conditions on the ground?
Sure, the 1,000 Kabul-centric, limits what you can do. No CT with that 1,000, so I believe we need a CT mission going forward to protect our homeland, to build the Afghan capability. So
seems to me that policy decision, which at one point was made, could not have possibly been based on any on-the-ground assessment of what we needed to do there. But to move on, I want to talk about something else that I mentioned in General Nicholson's hearing last week, and it's something that I picked up on when you briefed us last year, and that has to do with something that's really outside of your lane but very important. That's the economic assistance. You discussed in the hearing last year about the tail in 2017 and the need to sustain funding well beyond that. To what extent do you think our apparent reduction in force influences the investments that are made by other partners in the region and potentially puts that at risk?
So again, I can only speculate on that, but I know for sure that our forces going down have hurt the economy of Afghanistan. They were very dependent upon a lot of the influx of money that was provided based on the number of forces from the coalition, especially in the transportation arena and the services. So as we've come down, I'm sure that's had a negative effect on.
Do you think that the change in your testimony, you talked about how the Taliban have changed their strategies, they've extended the fighting season. Do you think that a reduction in that economic assistance, the continued changes in the Taliban could have a negative impact in terms of the conditions on the ground and stress a 5,500 troop level?
So well,
our risk assessment, likelihood of that actually stressing those levels.
Yeah, I'm not sure it would have an impact on the number, sir. But what it would do, it would give the Taliban, you know, the opportunity to use that against the national government, against coalition.
As we retreat to a strictly counterterrorism role, and the army, the Afghan army, and the police continue to deal with the counterinsurgency. How would you assess their ability as it exists today with 9,800 troops on the ground and their ability, let's say their ability now is on a scale, random scale of 1 to 10, let's say they're an 8 now with our train, advise, and assist capability. It's going to be reduced, obviously, with our withdrawal back to purely counterterrorism. How on that scale, does it stay the same? Is it appreciably lower in terms of their ability to take the fight to the Taliban without our trained advise and assist capabilities?
So you're not going to like the answer, but it depends. So if I can give you an example, you know, we've only been doing trained advise and assist at the Corps level on 4 of the 6 Corps, 2 that we came off of, the 203rd Corps in Ghazni and the 215th Corps in Helmand. There were 2 that we didn't have advisors there all the time. The 203rd Corps of the last fighting season led, because of the leadership of General Yaftali, the Corps commander, has actually done pretty well. And we haven't had to provide a lot of other advisors to them over this past fighting season. The 215th, completely different story. And that's because of the leadership, but also because of the threat and the fight they had down in Helmand. And I've had to apply more resources and have made Helmand the main effort for not only our advisors, but also the Afghans have made that their main effort over the winter campaign to build the 215th back up. So again, I think it does have a lot to do with leadership. But again, they value any advising they can get. President Ghani welcomes all of our nations. He welcomes to continue to professionalize both the Army and the police, and he knows that he needs the United States to lead to do that.
Well, General Campbell, I would maybe close with just a comment, but I will tell you, when we met there and we went to the forward operating base, we met with the Afghan general there, it was very clear to me what a confidence builder your presence was there and an inspiration for their troops just to execute at a higher level. It seems to me, as someone who's not served in the military, that reduction, there's going to be some proportionate reduction in their confidence as they're gaining their capabilities. But there was no doubt in my mind when that general looked over to you and your team and talked about what great mentors you were, that's a loss that they're going to feel. And hopefully the conditions on the ground will not change to a point to where we ultimately have to rebuild and go back in. The last thing I want to tell you is thank you for your service. I want you to seriously consider at least a retirement home near your 82nd Airborne, folks down Pinehurst. There's a golf course that I think is really going to gain some notoriety there that you may want to consider coming and spending time. A man of your stature, we would greatly welcome back to North Carolina. Thank you for your service.
So I'm looking at that. Thank you.
On behalf of the chairman, let me recognize Senator Sullivan. Thank you, Senator Tillis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, you probably know that a lot of members of the Army also retire in Alaska. So I want to make sure you keep that option open, too. We don't have such great golfing, but we got better hunting and fishing than North Carolina. So I hope you keep an open mind on that. But I, like all the other members of the committee, I want to thank you for your service. Exemplary service, and not only to you, but your family as well, because as you know, families serve when their members are serving, and so just want to thank the whole clan for your decades of service. I wanted to follow on the question that Senator King raised, and I'm just asking your view on it, because I think sometimes we actually, certainly I do, get a little confused on the difference when we have members of the military testifying in front of this committee. You broke down the difference between what you called a policy decision versus a military decision. to me, I'm not sure there's such a clear dichotomy. So how do you think we should be thinking about those issues? And let me give you an example. Was the troop strength decision a military decision, or was it a policy decision? Or did you bring a military decision to the civilian leaders and they came up with a different policy decision? I'm not clear what you meant by the distinction, and I'm not 100% sure there's a fine, you know, bright line between the two of them.
Sir, thanks for the question. So what I would tell you is that, you know, the military has an opportunity to provide its best military advice. And when we look at, as Senator McCain talked about earlier, the requirements and the capabilities required to accomplish a mission that you've been given by your senior leadership, in this case, the President of the United States. And so we take many different, we take some assumptions of that plan, we work through that, and usually there's three or four different courses of action. And the 5500 is probably one of those different courses of action. What I can't get into, sir, is all the giving back and going back and forth and taking a look at that from both from a military perspective and then as you engage with the interagency, because there's, you know, there, what we look at is risk to force and risk to mission. So, you know, the military absolutely has the responsibility to provide, you know, what it thinks is necessary to accomplish the mission. But there are also outside factors that tie into that that we have to understand. And if some of those come in and adjust the capability requirements that you need there, then what we're required to do is go back and say, okay, we can still do the mission, but the risk may be higher or the risk goes down. And so that's how I think we...
So your military decision in this case was the COAs that you provided on troop strength that came with certain risks depending on what the COA was. And the policy decision was ultimately the decision chosen by the President to go with 5,500. Is that a good way to think about it?
Well, so I think, again, the decision, ultimately the President makes the decision, and that's the policy that we follow. But, again, there's a lot of give and take as we go through there, and we have the opportunity at all different levels to provide our input. Sometimes the input is taken, sometimes it's not taken. But I think that's part of the process as we move through there. And I think we've learned many of those lessons over several years of how we work within this process to do that. And I'm very proud that, you know, we have great leaders like Joe Dunford and others, General Dempsey and others that have helped us get through this process. But we absolutely have to provide our input. And if we can't live with that, you know, if there's something we can't live with, then we have to say so.
Right.
And then,
okay.
We follow orders, sir, and you follow your last orders first. And
I appreciate
if you can't
that,
live with it, if it's not immoral, it's not illegal, all right, then you got to do the best of your ability to make sure that you can accomplish the mission.
Let me ask another question on the safe haven issue on the border between Afghanistan and Pakistan. Is that solvable? And if it's not solvable, do we have a perpetual problem with the Taliban, with the Haqqani network, with Al-Qaeda? I mean, how should we be thinking about that? Because it doesn't seem like that looks like it's going away anytime soon. And it certainly has had to be an enormous frustration for you to be ready for a fighting season and then know that some of the enemies that we and the Afghan army were battling go to the other side of the border, train, equip, rest, and then come back at us. How should we think about that issue, which seems to not get as much attention as it deserves, but in my view seems to be one of the most critical issues we face in the entire region?
Sir, thanks. Again, I think we have to continue to work with Pakistan. Pakistan and Afghanistan got to work together. They got to talk military to military and how they can get after a common enemy that knows no border, knows no boundaries. Transnational terrorism does that. Pakistan and Afghanistan have a lot of ungoverned space. This is going to be a problem for years and years and years. This is the terrorism piece is a generational issue. The one way that we can get after it is to continue to build upon the capability of the Afghan forces to fight this enemy. But, you know, I believe we're always going to need a CT presence of some sort as we continue to build their presence to keep pressure on so that we don't allow this transnational terrorism to come to the homeland of the United States.
And if I may, Mr. Chairman, I know my time's up, but seeing that I'm the Thank you. I just want to follow up on the last point you made. And one of the things that I think is important for our military leaders, civilian leaders, members of Congress, is make sure that we're having a discussion not only in these kind of settings, but with the American people on what the challenges that we face, what the cold truth on some of the challenges that we face. Because I think when we do that, you have better policy, you have better support, ultimately, from the American people, which is fundamentally critical to any successful policy. So let me just ask a final follow-up. You talk about a generational struggle. General Abizaid has talked about the Long War. And you've had experience battling the Long War for quite some time now. You know, one of the things that I think where the president hasn't really leveled with the American people is when we talk about, well, we've ended combat operations in Afghanistan. The CT mission is clearly a combat operation, and we had soldiers, unfortunately, killed recently. But can you talk about how we, again, should be thinking about this issue of what you term generational struggle? General Abizaid's talked about the Long War. You know, there's different models here. And some people talk about Korea. Some people talk about Germany. What's the historical analogy that we should be trying to think about with regard to our troop presence in Afghanistan or other regions where the threat of transnational terrorism is not going away next year? It's not going away 2 years from now. It's probably not going away in 5 years. How should we be thinking about that from a policy perspective, but also in terms of leveling with the American people?
Sure, thanks. Again, I do believe that, you know, that's transnational terrorism, it's a global threat. You know, 9/11 changed our lives forever. I think we're very fortunate that the men and women of our country, for the most part, you know, don't worry about a lot of it now because they have great men and women, less than 0.5% that continue to serve willingly, voluntarily, to do what they can to make sure that they're safe. And it's good that our
family— And are on offense in many parts of the world.
Absolutely. But again, they're going to continue to be bad people who want to do bad things to the United States and our way of life, and we shouldn't try to hide that. That's going to be out there. So we ought to do everything we can to continue to have the very best military in the world that we can, the strongest military. We're dependent upon Congress to provide us the money to be able to do that, and we appreciate that great support. But, you know, it's going to take a global effort. The U.S. can't do all this by itself. It's going to continue to take a global effort as we move forward. And I think we got to talk in those kind of terms. But it'll be hard to take a model like Germany or Korea or Japan or something like that to say, hey, we're going to continue to need 30,000. You know, I don't think we're in that case. Technology, you know, has changed the world we live in. So I think there's other ways to get after this. But bottom line is we're going to have to continue to keep pressure on it. And the way you do that is continue to provide the right equipment, the right training, and the right leadership for the men and women who volunteer to serve our country. And once you neglect them, then we're in trouble. And you know, after 37 years of being in the Army, almost 37 years of being in the Army, with my son, who I talked about the other day, who's at Fort Hood, Texas, who I haven't seen since August of 2014 in Jalalabad on his second tour, who's getting ready to go on his third tour. And if I didn't think this was important, what I said the other day is I'd tell him to get out of the Army. But I absolutely think it's important. And I think people need to go find ways they can serve our country. And the military is one way, and it's been very good to me. But again, sir, it's a global thing. We're going to have to stay on it. It's going to take continued leadership from the United States. And that's the only way I see it going in the future.
Well, General, thank you again for your exceptional service to our country and your son, and for that very wise wrap-up. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Sullivan. And on behalf of the chairman, I will thank you again for your testimony, for your extraordinary service to the nation, to the Army, and for your testimony this morning. With that, the hearing is adjourned.
Thank you, sir.